All right, everyone, if you could take your seats, I've got a little information for you. Nice scarf, Jerry. I like it. Listen, God blessed us with an amazing tag sale event. Again, I wanted to say thank you to everybody. I know I announced this before, but it was a very big success. And thank you for all your help. Thank you for, you know, everybody that volunteers in this church. I just want to tell you how much it's appreciated, okay? We really do have a lot of people who are willing to put in a lot of work to help this ministry grow. And I am just grateful to all of you who do that. So please know that from the bottom of our hearts. The theology and Bible course will pick back up this Wednesday evening at 6:30. Again, we are continuing to collect undergarments in the box for the parish cupboard. For the Springfield Rescue Mission, okay? Any new undergarments that you can donate would go right back in that box in the narthex out those doors there, and that will head right to the Springfield Rescue Mission. So, with that being said, does anyone feel like time is just flying by, right? Like, we blinked and all of a sudden, right? The holiday season is upon us, Thanksgiving is almost here. All right, and what I want to do today is I want to slow down and I want to let the Word of God speak to our heart and change us. And I want to let worship and praise fill our heart and glorify God. It's a simple thing. A simple thing. I'm not saying it's not a deep thing. I'm saying it's a simple thing. We are saying, God, I want to praise and worship you with all my heart, and I want you to continue to change my heart in the process. That's why we're here. That's what worship truly is. It's a chance to praise God along with our brothers and sisters in Christ, to feel that connection together, and to believe that as we worship and grow close to God, we can leave here differently than we came in. Do you believe that? And let's mean it when we worship. Let's mean it when we hear the word. And let's make this moment a time of transformation in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, that's it. Now, come on up. You wanted to say something?
One quick announcement.
Okay. Yes, Carol. You may.
Most of you know that October is Pastor Appreciation Month, and I want you to know we don't just appreciate you in October, but we appreciate you all year long for your leadership, your encouragement to each and every one of us, your support, and your love, and your faithfulness to your calling. And this is just our...
Thank you very much.
Tell
you the truth, I actually forgot that it was Pastor Appreciation Month, but thank you very much. It's much appreciated. I appreciate all of you. It's a whole month. How many days do I have left? Not much.
One.
With that being said, we're going to go to God in prayer. I feel in my heart like we should open up with prayer before the call to worship. And so I want us just to take a moment and be silent and still before God. And I want you to take the words that we just talked about having our hearts be filled with praise and having our hearts changed in the process. We're just going to take about 10, 15 seconds of silence, and then we'll open with prayer. Lord God, we believe in the power of the gospel to change lives. We believe in the power of worship to not only glorify you, but to feed our soul. Why is it, Lord, that the more we glorify and praise you, the more alive we feel inside? It must be that you've wired us that way. We are grateful that you did. And grateful for this time be glorified in our praise and worship today. We ask in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, Retok.
Good morning.
The call of worship this morning is taken from Psalm 77. Your way, O God, is holy.
You are the God who works wonders.
You have made known your might among the peoples. You with your arm redeemed your people. Amen. Let's praise the Lord.
All right, stand up, everybody. What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Here we go, leaning, leaning, safe and secure. I've been having this urge when we worship to get moving quickly and to remind all of you the many ways that people worshiped in Scripture. Sometimes in a very solemn way, sometimes in a very quiet way, and sometimes in a way that just got you moving, dancing. So with that being said, let's move a little bit. Let's dance. move a little bit all across the land. Fragrant breeze of heaven blowing once again. Moving a little bit.
Jesus Christ, I love it.
Who says you can't have fun in church?
How great is our God?
How great.
And all God's people say, amen. 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 Please be seated, everyone. At this time, we're going to collect our morning offering as an act of worship and faith and trust in Almighty God. There is junior worship today. It will be done right after the morning offering and after we sing our doxology. That being said, because we've kind of put this element back in, some may be thinking it's already time for junior worship. So why don't we do this as soon as we're done praying? We'll set all the youth of our church who would like to go to junior worship. Lynn, could you just raise your hand back there? She's leading the charge. They're ready. Listen, when they're ready, they're ready. What are you going to do? They said, we're out now. We're going to learn about Jesus. You guys collect your offering. We're going to learn about Jesus, and I like it. I like it. Amen. There is quite a group back there. Lynn, you may need some help. If you need some help, you let me know. I'm going to pass the mic over to Darren. He's going to preach the sermon. He doesn't know it yet, and I'm going with you. You ready, Darren? Listen, we're gonna sing our doxology as they come down. Please stand, everyone.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Lord, we ask your blessing on this offering today. We gave it as an act of worship and faith. We're reminded of the role that giving had in worship. In Jesus' time and throughout the scriptures. And so we are honored and happy to give. And we know we have a great responsibility to use what has been given to grow your kingdom and to honor and glorify you, Almighty God. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. So what we're going to do is I'm going to have Jim come up and read the scripture lesson. It's a short one, but a good one from the Word. Then I'm going to ask Tony if he would be kind enough to pray for the sermon and the message, and not just the delivery of the message, but the reception of the message. Tony, good?
You know what? Today, let's do this a little differently. Can you all stand, please? Let's read the scripture together. For as he thinketh in his
so is he. Eat and drink, say he to thee, but his heart is not with thee.
May God bless the reading of his word.
Good morning, Red Oak. Let us pray. Holy and eternal God, we come in prayer by faith in that name that is above every name. And the Bible says, at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow. Lord, let this be a time of not involuntary worship, but let this be a time, God, that we will bow our knees to this message today and receive this word from heaven. I ask you, Almighty God, that you would do an operation on every heart, that this heart may receive this word today. I ask you, Holy Spirit, to use Pastor Ryan like you have never used him before. Let the fire of your spirit, Holy God, come out of his mouth, consuming everything the enemy has planted in this church and in the heart of your peoples. Break the foul ground of every heart that it may be receptive, oh God, to what you have for us today. Father, we are grateful and thankful to be called children of the Most High. I pray, Lord God, for a special anointing in this place. Father God, I pray that you would just do a work in us that cannot be denied. Father, we ask that you would have your way. Use Pastor Ryan today, oh God, to speak to us. Father, there are some of us here today need a word from heaven. And I pray today will be our day of breakthrough. I pray today, God, today will be a day of revival. I pray today, God, today will be a day of refreshment. I pray today, God, that this would be a day of restoration, oh God, for, of that which has been broken by the enemy. Restore your people today through this word, oh God, and we will give your name the praise, the glory, and the honor. And all of God's children said,
amen. Thank you for that, Tony. You may not know it, but that is restoring God's people is precisely the point of today. So thank you for tuning into the Spirit as he led you in prayer. Amen? All right. So we read this scripture. Why don't you go ahead and throw it back up there? For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. This is the King James Version. You know, usually I use the ESV. But this is kind of the classic way that it's phrased. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. How many of you know who the philosopher René Descartes is? One. I saw one. Can I get two? Do I have two? Do I have three? I got three. Okay, four. All right. Not many of us know René Descartes. I'm not giving you any Christian principle from René Descartes. I am simply going to state that he had a founding philosophical principle that he based his entire philosophy on. And I bet you that a lot more of you have heard of this founding principle than have heard of his name. I think, therefore I... you came to life. I think, therefore I am. And he went on to build his entire philosophy, which connected thinking and existence together. All right? He even went on to say, if I doubt that I exist, I am still thinking when I doubt. So if I doubt, I think, and if I think, I am. Therefore, you cannot doubt your own existence. If you didn't get that, it's okay. It's not what the message is about. I'm not preaching the gospel of René Descartes. I'm simply trying to make the point that it's been long understood there is a correlation between thinking and life. Thinking and existence, the ability to reason, rationalize, and everything projecting out from there. But with the spiritual man, with the spiritual mind, we believe that the essence of life is not even just your ability to think, but lies in the very soul of a man. That the soul is the essence, the starting point of life. And so I have a question for us. I think this is the question for us from a Christian, a Christocentric point of view. Is what we project to others, right? As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Is what we project to others really coinciding with what we think down deep? Does it match? Is it really a product, what we show to other people? Is it really a product of who we truly are inside? Or does something or someone, the man within, get lost along the way? Are we authentic and genuine in what we project? Or do we hide the soul and project what we want others to think, not what we truly think? It's going to be a little bit of a heavy discussion today. A down-home, heavy discussion in the gospel today. Does our soul, what we would say is the essence of being, from our point of view, does the soul become masked along the way because of what other people think, not because of what we truly think? The title of today's sermon is I Think, Therefore I Am, But Am I What I Think? Am I truly living it out? Is there a correlation between what's shown on the outside and what's truly on the inside? And I'm going to say this because eternal life, our faith in Jesus Christ, ought to be authentic and real. Jesus is the life giver. He gives us new life. Either he's real and our whole life is devoted to it, or it's all just a myth. You got to decide where your heart is. You got to decide where that heart beats today. Because when Jesus walks out of the empty tomb, either he defines life for us going forward and our whole lives are devoted to it, or else we're just playing church, and I don't want to play church. I left churches because in my early youth, well, not even in this state, you don't even know, I watched what I thought was church playing. I watched people arguing over and over again, bringing lawyers to business meetings in a church. The church has since closed. It's either genuine and authentic, or we're all just playing games. I hope you enjoyed the worship set. Yeah, I'm going to speak extremely blunt today. Eternal life has to be based on authentic life. Eternal life has to begin now. We think of eternal life simply as something that's coming down the pipe for us, but you know, I've said this many times, authentic life is a quality of life, not just a quantity of life. It's a quality of life that begins now and never stops. That's how scriptures define eternal life. It's an authentic life. And so it leads us to the scripture. And I got to tell you, this scripture, as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Can you put that up for me? Yeah, you're already there. Nicely done. Okay? Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. Listen, the saying, for as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he, has been quoted many times. And actually, I got the idea for this sermon because Pastor Don quoted this in a random conversation, not even having to do with what I'm preaching about. We were talking about, just being positive in life, okay? And he quoted, as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And that's usually where this verse, you know, people quote it. They do right up to the first sentence. So as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. But notice the other part. Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee. There's something more going on here. And we didn't quote that part in our conversation. And so I started today's message early on in the week saying, I'm going to preach on the power of positive thinking. As someone thinks in their heart, that's what's going to define them. And I had this whole thing about the power of positive thinking. And then I got to the word, and I looked it up in the translation I normally use, the ESV, and here's what it says. I'm going to back up one verse to verse 6, okay? Do not eat the bread of a man who is stingy. Wait a minute. This is setting up this power of positive thinking. Do not desire his delicacies. And here's the part we know as, for as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Here's the way the ESV translates it. For he is like one who is inwardly calculating. And I went, what? This doesn't sound like the verse I'm looking up. Eat and drink, he says to you, but his heart is not with you. And I'm going, I'm looking for the verse. I actually started to doubt whether I had it right. I went to the ever informational age of Google and said, for a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And it brought up Proverbs 23:7. And I'm like, why is the ESV saying, like one who is inwardly calculating? Then I looked it up in the NIV. And it's like one who is inwardly calculating. Then I looked it in the NASB. There's a lot of translations out there. We won't go through them all today. I'll just say to you, none of them seem to fit. And I'm like, wait a minute. So I started digging in this verse. Okay, you're going to get a little scriptural lesson today. Okay? Started digging in this verse. And literally in the Hebrew, it means this. He is like one who calculates in his soul. his soul, and I dug up the word soul, and it's connected to the heart in Hebrew. Why? Because the heart of a man is where the Hebrew culture believed was the center of life. They believed life was found, anyone know, in the blood, which is why we talk about being a new creation in the blood of Jesus Christ. They believed that in the heart, and they talk about the heart as the place where passions and desires, as if that has more to do with life, and it's the center, it's the soul of a person. It's like the center soul, and they believed that even in the heart and soul of a man is where the first breath would come and where the last one would leave. It was the center of life. And so I'm starting to dig in this verse, like, okay, right? The heart is the center of life because life was thought to be in the blood. The heart pumps the blood. The soul is this inner being with a breath that comes at birth and goes out to death. And it's interesting that this inner being of man is where all your true, sincere passions and desires come from. Even when you start thinking one way, it's almost like, well, there's something else brewing in here. Here's what this passage from Proverbs truly says, and then I'll end the academic portion of today's sermon. This is Pastor Ryan's translation. It is not, I'm not saying to quote it this way, but here's my interpretation of it. Do not eat the bread of a man who is stingy. Do not desire his delicacies, for he is as one whose desire to feed you is not really in his heart and soul at all. As he thinks about it in his inner being, it does not match what he says, for it's not really who he is. Who we project to others is not always the same as who's in that breath of life, that center of life. Not reflecting on the outside what's really on the inside, the soul of a man. And so I'm going to say to you again, when I first started this sermon, I looked for as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. We're going to talk about all the things that we're going to affirm and how that's going to. And then the word of God challenged me this week and said, I felt like the Lord put on my heart, no, Ryan, you are going to preach about hypocrisy because that's what that verse is really talking about. Hypocrisy. Saying one thing and doing another. And if it's a little fiery and brimstone, Scripture says what the Scripture says. And Jesus has a lot to say about it. A lot to say about the dangers of hypocrisy. And if you may think this is fire and brimstone, but I see it as something that can help heal the soul. Because brothers and sisters, in 2 decades of counseling people, one of the things that I'm absolutely convinced is our mental health oftentimes declines when what we portray is not really who we are. Amen? And so we're going to talk about being real and being authentic because I believe if Jesus is life, if he is the way and the truth and the life, he defines what true authentic life is, then we should be the most genuine and authentic people on the planet. And I don't know if we're always seen that way. Sometimes those remarks are unfair from people because they just love to give us a shot, but sometimes we have to look in the mirror. And I'm speaking to us all. If you think I'm preaching at you, listen, I'm preaching to myself. You don't think I don't know that there are ways that what I do doesn't match what I say? You don't think there's ways that I don't know in my heart that who I really am and who I really want to be and who God's forming me to be don't always come out the right way? If I can do it, I was talking about this on Tuesday after I preached it with Pastor Don, and if he can do it, I'm sure every one of us can here. I am asking you, no, I'm begging us, when we preach about hypocrisy today, do not look to the left or to the right, not forward or behind, look within. Look within, and I believe we will find something healing here today, amen? Because Jesus, brothers and sisters, speaks very blunt words, so forceful words about hypocrisy, and he spoke it to the religious institutions of the time. To the religious leaders of the time. So before we want to project it out there, we got to start here. We got to look at the plank in our own before we look at the speck in the other. Almost escaped me there. He has forceful words, so forceful that I think we should take them more seriously, and quite frankly, I think they should be preached more often, even if it's not warm and fuzzy. And so the trick to learning authentic life is to view the words of Christ
not to the person to your left, not as spoken to the person on your right, but to that, as I said last week, that thief that too often lives within. Remember that thief we talked about last week? Who robs us of what that authentic life is. Look at what Jesus says, Matthew 12, 34. You brood of vipers. That's not the passive Jesus that we so, you know, walking around in his Birkenstocks that we so often hear. You brood of vipers, how can you speak good when you are evil? Notice this, for out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. The mouth speaks because something in here is trying to get out. And it isn't always good. The good person out of his good treasure brings forth good. What's his treasure? The good stuff in his heart. And the evil person out of the evil treasure brings forth evil. I tell you, on the day of judgment, people will give account for every careless word they speak. For by your words you will be justified, and by your words you'll be condemned. See, what the heart is filled with is going to overflow. And I use this analogy in counseling all the time, right? And I actually got this from Pastor Don, who got it from who knows where, right? But a lot of times, who we really are is like a beach ball that you try to push under the water, right? And what happens when you take an inflated beach ball and you push it? The further down you push it, the harder it wants to what? Soar up. Well, that has a lot to do with what I believe is truly down in the heart and what Jesus is saying in here, that there is an abundance of things, a force in here that wants to come out. And if it's filled with hypocrisy, the things that are good, things that aren't good, there's not going to be the good stuff to come out of it. We see this. We see it time and time again. We see it in our politics. We see it in society. We see it in our schools. We see it with people we look up to. We see it with celebrities. Amen. But shame on us if we don't see it within ourselves. Shame on me if I don't see it within me. Sometimes if you want healing, you got to be real with yourself. How does this change? I think it's something that we all wrestle with. If anybody here is going to tell me that every word they've ever spoken has been real and authentic, and it's always a direct reflection of the pureness that is in their heart at all times and in all situations with all people, talk to me afterwards. I've got some scriptures I would love to show you. How does it change? We see it everywhere, but I'm not worried about what they're doing or Hollywood's doing. I'm worried about what we're doing because I believe God established the church to help change the world. Yeah, I do. But we better be authentic and we better be real. We better not be saying one thing out of this side of our mouth and another thing with this, because we do that sometimes, right? In this crowd, I'm going to act one way. In this crowd, I'm going to act another way. When I'm around my family, here's the way we'll act. But on Sunday morning when I'm in a pew, let it not be so. Let it not be so. How does it change? How can we get change? And I think, ironically, in one of Jesus's most blunt and hard sayings, I think is the key to how this can change. Are you ready for it? That's weak. Are we ready for it? Yes. Matthew 23:27. Woe to you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites. Woe to you, religious leaders of the time. Or being saying one thing one way and another thing another way and aren't showing what's truly inside. For you are like whitewashed tombs. What's a whitewashed tomb? It's squeaky clean on the outside, but dead on the inside. Outwardly appear beautiful, but within are full of dead people's bones and all uncleanliness. Listen, I know this is a season where people wear masks, all right? I know this is a season where people dress up, but the masks that we too often wear go a lot longer than October. The masks that we wear last a lot longer than October. The real ones, I think we need to be more concerned with the masks we wear to hide the heart than the masks we wear to hide the face. Because it's a danger, and Jesus speaks hard to it. How can what is dead on the inside, notice, outwardly whitewashed tombs appear beautiful, but dead on the inside? He's asking the same question that was asked of Ezekiel by the Spirit of God in Israel at the time. How can these dry bones come alive again? How can what is dead come to life? And brothers and sisters, the point, the driving point of this message is we all need a heart transplant from the Spirit of God. Every one of us. Every one of us has to take seriously the verse that we quote 17 million times in this church. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. But there's more. You are a new creation in Christ, Paul says. There's a mystery, he says, that's passed down to the ages, which is Christ in you. That in Christ you're already seated at the right hand of God. And when he appears, the real you is going to come forward. We all need a heart transplant. It's the center and core of the gospel. If you don't believe me, listen to the prophet Ezekiel as he tells what the Lord spoke of his heart to his heart about a new covenant coming to Israel, a new covenant that we see fulfilled in Jesus Christ. Look at Ezekiel 36, 26. Say it with me. I will give you a new, say it again. I will give you a new heart. I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. Until we get that new heart, none of this gospel stuff will make any sense. I have watched people who were the most against the gospel, who sought to destroy it, who sought to tear it down, who got in the word and went into the scriptures to undo them. Read Josh McDowell's testimony on this. He went in the Bible to just tear it apart. And something happened. And it's called a heart transplant from God. And he's now one of the leading, he's been for years, one of the leading pioneers of the Christian movement. Without a heart transplant, listen, this is your basic bread and butter gospel message today. Unless a man is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And brothers and sisters, the idea of being reborn has been mocked and laughed at in our culture, and I don't care. It is a cornerstone of the gospel that Jesus can take through the Spirit of God, a heart that's filled with hypocrisies, a heart that cannot know God on its own, and change it into something beautiful and something of God. The Spirit of God, that to me, the empty tomb and the heart transplant that we get are the cornerstones of our faith in Jesus Christ. If Jesus Christ, if the tomb was empty on Easter morning, then our hearts can be transformed. And if our hearts can be changed from a heart of stone to a heart that beats for God, then anything in your life is possible. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Then God, give me a heart for you. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Then God, give me a heart for you. That's what today is about. That's what tomorrow is about, because that's what the gospel is about. It's about having a new life. It's having God change something so deep within us to be reborn of the Spirit. It says you can't even see the kingdom without it. You're going to be blind to it. Unless God changes your heart, you're going to be blind to it. You're going to be blind to God. You're going to be blind to what the scriptures say. But tell me the truth to those who've experienced it. Once God changes your heart, you never see it the same way again. And nobody can take it from you. This isn't fire and brimstone from a negative point of view. This is fire and brimstone for thank God he can change me. See, if you walk in here proud of yourself, thinking you're up here, well, this sermon's a bummer. If you walk into the pew and it's your hour of, oh, this sermon's a letdown. But if you walked in this place today saying, God, I still can't get it all right. Change me. Change me. Not the person in the pew next to me or behind me. Change me. Then this is the best message that you can hear. The status of your heart will determine how you receive this message. A new heart I'm going to give you, and then you're going to know me. That doesn't sound like a bummer to me. Man, that sounds like life. Like real, genuine, authentic life. Like something I would want to pursue and help frame everything I do in life. Like I want it to be real and genuine. I want it to mean something. I don't want to go through the motions. I don't want to show up in a pew so I can get my get out of hell free card. Do not pass go. Do not collect $200. I want it to matter. I want it to be the essence of who I am. I don't want the old me to live. I want the new creation in Christ to thrive. It's the old Ryan who got himself in more trouble than he would like to recount up here on the pulpit. But it's real. I want to live. I want us to truly know what it means to live. I think, therefore I am. But am I just a product of what I think? Or is there a mismatch? Did something go haywire along the way? And if so, and it should all be so, then the greatest message I can give you is the one that Jesus gave. There is new life in the blood of Jesus Christ. And the blood of Jesus Christ gives us life. Because when you come to faith, and I want you to hear me real clear because I mean this with all my heart. When you come to the saving faith of Jesus Christ, I want you to know what you're saying. You're saying, God, I am asking you to take this heart and give me his. Give me Jesus' heart. That's what we're asking. The gospel is no less than that. Oh, we can stack on other things, but it's no less than that. I am asking you to take this heart out and give me Jesus's so I can think like him, so I can live like him. For as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Then give me the heart of Christ. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Then please, Lord, give me the heart of Jesus. As a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. Then the greatest thing you can do is give me a heart that beats like yours and beats for you. That, brothers and sisters, is the gospel. That is the good news. That is the heart. Work your way into that soul from the first breath I take to the last that I exhale. Let eternal life start now. Amen? I want to give you a closing illustration. Comes from an article written on August 13th, 2018, from the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center. Ready? This woman had to have a heart transplant, and it wasn't looking good for a while. And as I read her story, I realized that from a spiritual point of view, wow, could I relate? Wow, can we relate? And I have some suspicions that this woman knew her Savior, too. You'll see. She writes, for several years, I struggled with severe heart failure. No matter what medication my cardiologist in Fort Worth tried, I continued to get worse. You ever feel that way? Like spiritually? No matter what I try, I just can't get this heart to do what I really want to do. Paul says it. Why do I do the things I don't want to do?
And the things I want to do, I don't. During my lowest point, I wanted to give up. I wanted to die. I couldn't bear the suffering any longer. My family had to help me do everything around the house, and I was perpetually tired. I didn't have any hope. I didn't have anything. I just couldn't bear the suffering anymore. Before my heart transplant, I was dying. Brothers and sisters, before Jesus Christ gives us a new heart, we are dying because he is the life. Amen? In 2004, I suffered two heart attacks and fell into a coma. My doctor took my husband aside and said, there's nothing more we can do for her. She's not responding to the medication. If anyone can save your wife, it's the specialists in Dallas. And my cardiologist sent me to the University of Texas Southwestern Medical Center, still unconscious, and everyone hoped for the best. After 2 to 3 days, my heart team revived me, and I was full of wires. I had a pacemaker outside my neck. When Dr. Dresner saw him, when I first saw his face after I awoke, he immediately made me feel calm. He was there for my family and for me for the 18-month wait on a heart transplant list. Can you imagine being hooked up like this and just waiting 18 months? During that long wait, I hoped and I prayed everything would turn out okay. I'm not going to lie, I was nervous. But I was happy at the same time because I had a lot of faith that got me through. And then my precious gift came. See, that heart transplant is a precious, precious gift. October 31st, 2007, at 6 a.m., the heart transplant was performed, and I woke up 12 hours later at 6 p.m. with no pain in my chest from the surgery, and all the doctors were surprised. In fact, I felt better than I had in years. It was truly amazing. I had no complications, no fevers, no high blood pressure, nothing. Felt the best I felt. And then she decided when it was time to go home that she needed to reach out to her donor's parents, to her donor's mother. Right away, I wanted to meet my donor's family if they were willing. I wanted to know the people who gave me my life back. If they hadn't made that difficult choice, I wouldn't be here today. I'd be dead. So she reached out by letter. In 2008, about a year after the transplant, I sent the letter. And right away, the family called and said they were eager to meet me as well. My donor's mother and I were both crying on the phone. And she said, we live in Corpus Christi. Maybe we could come see you. And this woman said, no, my whole family's coming to see you. So I loaded up my husband and my children. We drove to Corpus Christi. And I'll never forget the emotions of that first encounter. When my donor's mother and I locked eyes, we began to weep. I took her hand and I put it on my chest and I told her, here is your son's heart. And it's mine now. We both laughed and then we cried again. And this woman and I have continued a friendship, she writes, that goes on. We call every week. We visit a couple times a year. And she's now family. Brothers and sisters, we don't have to wait to meet our donor's family. Because Jesus says, when he gives us his heart, I will not leave you as orphans, I will come to you. And he says, when you see me, you see the Father. And I can't help but think that when God gave us Jesus Christ, that he took our hand and he put it on our head, on our heart, and he said, that's my son's heart. And it's yours now. And we're family. As we thinketh in our heart, so are we. Let us be the most genuine and authentic people that this world has ever seen. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, I know that there's a reason that I couldn't get this verse out of my head, even since back when we were just talking about it casually. And I know, God, that there's a reason that once I got into it,
you took me on a very different path. And I know I needed to hear it. But I also hope that there's somebody here who needed this too. I hope that in many ways we all did. And I thank you, God, for the miracle of rebirth. I thank you for the miracle of new creation. And I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you continue to grow us, that you have not abandoned us, that we can take our hand, put it on our heart, and know that your heart beats with us. And that because of it, we see not only the kingdom, we see our Father in heaven who loves us so dearly. I pray if anybody was touched here today, if they haven't received you and want that heart, or if they haven't been viewing that gift that they got so long ago as the precious gift that it is and taking it for granted, Lord, I pray, just as Tony mentioned earlier, that there's a renewal that happens here today. We ask in your name. Amen. In this last song, I'm going to invite anybody who would like to pray. I know Tony, Jim, Lynn. Oh, Lynn, they're off in junior worship. If there's people that would just like to pray, Irene, I know you could pray. Anybody, if you guys want to just come together in prayer, if anybody needs prayer, or if you just want to get together in prayer, I'm going to invite you down, okay? And either during this last song or come see us at the end, and we would love to pray with you.
So much we have lost as we look down the road where all the prodigals have walked, and one by one the enemy has whispered lies and led them off as slaves. But we know that you are God, yours is the victory. We know that
come alive, come alive. do this with me. We're not done. Breathe the breath of God.
Breathe the breath of God. Breathe the breath of God now. Breathe
to that inner soul and heart of a man.
Breathe
to all your children.
Tony's going to give us a benediction prayer.
Amen. We know that some of you here today might not have ever experienced the presence of God, nor have ever received an invitation to receive His Son as your Savior. I need you to understand that this is not MGM. You don't take chances with Jesus Christ. Before you leave this earth, you need to know that you know that you know that you are going to enter into the kingdom of heaven. Heaven is for eternity. Hell is for eternity. Why sit and take a chance? Pastor Ryan has preached a powerful message today about the heart. You and I know that there are some things in our heart that we just can't get out of. You and I know that there's things that we are doing we just can't get away from. The enemy has a stronghold. But I need you to understand that Jesus Christ came to set you free. The Bible said He came to set the captives free. If you're dealing with anything in your heart today, I pray that you would give it. Oh, my God. I pray that you would give it to Jesus. I pray that you will not leave this place the same way you came in. I pray, God, that you will be transformed and renewed. Some of you have never made Jesus Christ the Lord of your life. But I want to give the invitation today. I know you're not going to come down. But you can be saved right where you're at in your stoop, in your seat. And if you want to be saved today, I want you to pray after me, and I want you to believe that Jesus Christ has the power to set you free from the enemy. Let us pray corporate. Say, God, I'm a sinner. I need your Son, Jesus Christ, to be my Redeemer, my Savior, and my salvation. Satan, I serve you notice. You are not my God. Jesus Christ is my Redeemer. Jesus Christ is my Savior. I receive Him today as my Lord and as my Savior. And if I leave this place today, I know that I will appear in heaven in front of Jesus Christ as redeemed and washed in His blood. Lord, we thank you for those that receive Christ today. Though they might not have stepped out in the middle of the aisle, Lord, though they might not have came forward, but you saw their prayer, Lord God, in the earnesty of their hearts are being transformed by this message that was preached today, and I'm so grateful, Lord. Father, as we leave this place today and not your presence, go with us, protect us, and we know that we have your Son, Jesus Christ, the hope of glory on the inside. We have the power of the gospel on the inside of us. I pray, God, for transformation to continue in their lives, Lord God. And I ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ.
God bless you, everyone. Go in peace. Know that your Savior loves you. Amen.